Dr. Avinash, the next question could be where you pointed out something on combination of medicine and counseling hand in hand. So how far do you think that medication really helps in stability all the time? And also, you know, we have experienced that many times say, oh, I'm feeling better now, so then the medicine told me. So how that is also obviously detrimental, and at what point do you suggest that you know the person then steps into the area of counseling around the place?
Well, I think, see, very acute cases of very severely depressed, so they are violent, or they are aggressive, or they are in a psychotic mode, where they have no insight that they are in. It may be very difficult at that time to look at initiating any counseling. So, generally, we do prescribe medications because we want them to first stabilize emotionally, mentally. Even from a very severe depression, they may not speak at all, neither would they be receptive to, you know, any counseling. So, the medication will at least lift their mood a bit, bring them to a level where they open up, start expressing themselves, and then we could initiate counseling. Okay. So, counseling works when, you know, I generally ask the patient three or four things. I mean, what kind of a person are you? Would you like, you know, to open up and speak to someone and discuss things very openly? Or would you, you know, be the type who wants to just listen and take advice? So generally, I mean, there are two types of patients. One that prefer to listen to a therapist or listen to a doctor and take advice, and the one who wants like an interactive session where they talk and discuss, so it would be there. So that, based on that, of course, we decide. Apart from that, I also very often they say, you know, I think I'm not right now mentally ready to go into counseling. Like, patients have that insight, so I very often tell them, okay, you first stabilize and then we will, you know, look at counseling. And very often they say, I have been through a lot of trauma, but I am not ready to talk about it right now. So when in such cases, then we have to probably wait. So medication plays a very important role, because one is it works at the brain level, it changes our neurochemical makeup, and as a result, you know, you open up a bit, your inhibitions go down, you become more amenable to suggestion, you listen. You also become more flexible in the sense that if someone suggests something, you don't say no, you're more open to that suggestion. And I think even in a therapy session, what happens is you become more communicative, you become more expressive, you also are able to talk about negative aspects and dramatic things in your life without probably breaking down as much as you would have had without medication. And I think finally what also happens is that you also become more receptive to the therapist's suggestions. So medication definitely works in that way, and your focus in therapy sessions is also better, there's no doubt on that front. So medications work from that perspective, and I normally tell the patient on day one that if you're a case of depression or anxiety, you will have to take medication for at least maybe a year and a half or 2 years, based on whether this is your first episode or second episode or third episode, you know, the duration would differ. In a patient with schizophrenia, I very clearly tell them that you will, it's a long-term illness, and you will need medication for at least probably 5 years. So, you know, I'm saying if you are lucky, you would reduce it earlier. So, you know, keep mentally prepared that you're going to take long-term medication. So even if you're going to start medication, don't think that this is malaria or dengue, that it's a 15-day course, and you know, you're going to be fine. Or don't think that, you know, it is a medical illness that, you know, you have a one-month course and you're fine. I tell them, even an illness like TB has a 9-month course of medication, so this is a psychiatric problem, so there is a 1.5-year course of medication that you have to take. And I tell them, we'll taper the medication. We initially may start with more medication, taper it down, we stabilize you on probably 2 or 3 medicines, and you will be maintained on that. But also remember that it's not that you keep blindly taking the medication. So we have to review month by month. You have to follow up. If you feel changes have to be made, changes will be made. And we tell them this is not like, again, like malaria, TB or dengue, that, you know, there's a course that fits everyone. No. This is highly individualized treatment. So we have to see which medicine suits which person. So for example, I give them an example of, say, benadryl cough syrup. I tell them some people feel sleepy with it, some people do not feel sleepy with it. Or for sedlin, that everyone knows is used in cold, some people tolerate it, some don't tolerate it. Similarly, psychiatric medication, the effects are highly individual. Some people show very good response, some may show moderate response, some may show no response, and then we may change medication. So we have to monitor. So this is something which I tell them is very central. Another thing I request them is that please give your doctor at least around 8 weeks time, you know, before deciding he's no good. Don't just, you know, go to your doctor for 2 weeks and then, you know, shift to your doctor every 2 weeks. If you're going to do that, you never really benefit. So, you know, the medicines will take at least a month or two to work. So, stick with your doctor. So, if you don't do well, you can blame him. And if you do well, you can thank him. Both ways, you know, you can, you know, remain. So, it's important that, you know, you remain with the same doctor. Even with counseling, I tell them, you know, please stick for at least 3 to 4 months with a counselor. And, you know, regularly go for counseling. So, don't just go for two sessions and say, the counselor was not good or whatever. Yes, I always tell them it can happen. Counseling is a very human process. You may go for a session or two and feel that I'm not liking that counselor. You know, I'm not very comfortable. That can happen. I said, even if you come to me, it can happen that, you know, you're not very comfortable with me. You may find me too imposing. You may find me, you know, at times, no, I don't just gel with, you for some reason. Well, then there are options available. But you know, if you don't go regularly and then you invest, or you don't follow the exercises they're asking you to do at home, and then you expect results to come, you know, it's not going to happen. And I tell them it's like physical therapy. You may go once a week or twice a week, but you have to do those exercises every day at home. Only then it's going to help you. So this is, I mean, my own way of probably, you know, telling them. So the first time I meet them, I mean, I generally slot out like a 45-minute, 1-hour session for a new patient. And I tell them that there are a lot of things we are going to talk to you about. So that, you know, a lot of time in the follow-up is not wasted, that, you know, you didn't tell us this or you didn't tell us that. So I tell them, on day one, I prefer to put all the cards before you so that, you know, you have a choice. So, and then there are some patients who say, no, we don't want to go for medication right now. So I tell them, there are some of you who I feel need medication. There is no alternative. So then I tell them very clearly, you have to go for medication. But then there are some who say, okay, I mean, do you think I can manage with counseling, or I would like to try for a month or a month and a half with counseling and then consider the medication? Then I tell them, fine, I mean, we'll go with you if your case is not very severe based on my assessment. But if I feel severe, I'll say, no, I think at least one tablet at night you start along with counseling, you know, something like that. So it's a list of medication that worries them, you know, I'll be on 3 or 4 medications. So I tell them, take one medicine, start with one, we may increase it once you, and I think once the patient feels a little better with medication, his confidence in your treatment also comes, and his confidence in the fact that medicines work comes, and then I think he becomes more and more amenable to adjustments in medication.
Absolutely. So thank you so much. I think it's along with the confidence in the doctor, they also start developing the confidence in themselves as well, that this is working and I can get better.
Another thing I would just say, you see, a lot of patients feel that, you know, the psychiatrist only speaks. He doesn't really, you know, probably, you know, check me up or assess me or, you know, whatever. So I always say that, whenever any patient comes to me, it's like I personally check their pulse, I personally check their blood pressure. So, you know, that medical model remains that, you know, I am, in India what happens is, you know, doctor ne mujhe chhua bhi nahi. You know, that's a very common thing that people have, you know, he only saw me and prescribed. So generally what I do is I check their blood pressure, and which is I feel we must, so I generally check it. I check their pulse so that, you know, you come to know. And I just put a stetho, examine them like a routine examination, which I think is essential, because anyone who's complaining of anxiety and restlessness, I would just want to put a stetho to rule out anything detail. So they at least feel, you know, that you check them up and then have labeled them as being psychologically. Otherwise, they feel that, you know, you just directly told them, you know, that you have a psychiatric problem or whatever. And they very often ask you, I mean, this I learned a little early in my practice, because patients would say, aapne dekha nahi, tapasa nahi, sir, aise bol rahe. So then I realized that patients probably feel more confident, you know, and then they feel, you know, you're a doctor, you're not, I mean, they generally otherwise get confused, there's no stetho, there's nothing, I mean, outcome, you're a doctor. In India particularly, that concept is there.
Yes, I'm so agree with you on that. And I think it's a fantastic strategy that, you know, you are taking, and I think that also builds confidence, you know, you
I don't mind sharing it here, like, even if while you're taking his pulse or his blood pressure, you know, if you tell him, see, don't worry, this is nothing big, you can get okay or whatever. The fact that you're near him and, you know, you're practically holding his hand, not holding his hand actually, but taking his pulse and, you know, telling him, it's like a reassuring thing for him that, you know, I'm going to be fine. So he does feel better, you know, when you do that. rather than just sitting across the table and telling him.
Yes. So that will look formal and this will look very, you know, that inclusive basically. Yeah. Okay. So fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the review.